It is July 14th, 2020, and I will continue from my last video in which I was expressing my skepticism about the name of this new virus. The name is SARS coronavirus 2, and it is presumed that this is the successor to SARS coronavirus 1. Now, I don't agree to that at all because, as I mentioned earlier, SARS was a disease of fever accompanied by myalgia, headaches, body aches, and at most a pneumonia or some pathology of the lungs. The virus disappeared after 2 years, never to come back again. And the most important fact is that the genetic similarity to that virus is only 79%, that is less than 80% commonality with SARS-1. Now that is about the genetic features. Clinically, there is a huge difference between SARS-1 and this new China virus. Clinically, it is now becoming quite obvious that this does not only affect the lungs, it most certainly affects numerous other organs in the body. In fact, all the important organs are affected by this virus. And very recently, Nature has published a review article with the lead author being an Indian origin scientist. And the review article clearly states that apart from the lungs, you can have the heart being affected, the liver, the kidneys, even the endocrine system, the intestines, and above all, even the brain. The virus is affecting all these organs. So I will walk you down some of the organs. Let's take diabetes to begin with, because a lot of people have diabetes. Now this virus is notorious for increasing blood glucose, particularly in patients already having diabetes or hidden diabetes. Even if you do not have diabetes, there is a chance that the blood sugar may go up. Now the reason for that are, the reasons are two. Number one is that probably the virus affects the pancreas directly. The cells which produce insulin in the body are destroyed by this virus. Or the other theory is that the virus creates this hyperimmune reaction. There is formation of interleukin-6. The IL-6 attacks the beta cells of the pancreas, and by doing that, produces less insulin production and causes the blood sugar to go up. Now, apart from the rise in blood sugar, the other serious thing is that this virus can cause what is called diabetic ketoacidosis, ketosis, and also euglycemic ketosis, which means there is ketosis in the absence of raised blood glucose. So what is the importance, what is the impact of these observations? The impact is that when you use medicines in a patient of diabetes who is suffering from COVID-19, you have to be careful with what you're doing. To begin with, now if you use a sulfonylurea, which is used very commonly, you can compromise the heart, because this virus also attacks the heart. If you use the new drugs, the very, very good drugs, which are used for diabetes and patients of heart failure, these are the pseudo-sodium glucose cotransporter inhibitors, SGLT2 inhibitors. These could aggravate or induce more ketosis, because they themselves act by producing some ketosis in the body. If you use metformin, then you must be careful about the kidneys, because the virus can affect the kidneys also. So the safest thing to do is to use insulin when a patient is admitted, and there is a very high chance that the dosage of insulin will be above normal in these patients. So apart from the endocrine system, I will take first the brain. Now there is this excellent article published in The Lancet very recently from the United Kingdom, It includes 150 patients who had a brain pathology. Of these 150 patients admitted across the United Kingdom, about two-thirds had strokes. Of these two-thirds patients, two-thirds had what is known as ischemic stroke. That means that some blood vessel going to the brain got blocked and there was a brain infarction or a brain attack. And one-third of these people had a hemorrhage within the brain or between the brain and the skull. Now, the exact cause of the hemorrhage is unknown. Maybe the vessel walls are damaged by the virus, right? And the other thing is that the virus may directly affect the brain of the patient. No. And by affecting the brain directly or indirectly, you have the very interesting situation of encephalitis. That means there is a viral inflammation of the brain. Now, how do you diagnose that? People who have inflammation of the brain usually lose their consciousness to a large extent. They become stuporous. They may behave in an abnormal manner. They might have some weakness in some parts of their body. They may actually go into stupor or coma. And the confirmation is, of course, always the PCR test or the actual examination of the cerebrospinal fluid, which is also called the CSF. And one must look out for the presence of cells, increased cells in the CSF, increased proteins, and of course, if possible, the virus itself. Now, I mention this because a very close friend of mine from childhood has recently been admitted in a major hospital in Delhi with behavior changes. And the MRI has been done. The MRI has not shown any signs of inflammation. But the important thing is that this gentleman, who is middle-aged and has been an athlete, an outstanding athlete in his youth, he in fact was the champion runner of Delhi University when he was young. This gentleman had sudden onset of cognition impairment, confusion, behavioral changes, personality changes, and also lack of sleep. Now these were his symptoms. The other thing is that a very close member of the family had suffered from fever about a fortnight back. The fever stayed for about 2 or 3 days. There was not much of a cough. That person was tested for COVID. The test came out negative. So my own clinical suspicion is, because I've known the person for years and years and years, for decades. Now, I don't believe there has been a sudden breakdown. There has been no sudden psychiatric calamity. But there is a very strong suspicion that maybe the other family member who had the fever actually had COVID, because you must appreciate the fact that when you test for the COVID using the swab in your nose, the sensitivity or the pickup rate is about 60 to 65%. You can miss the virus in about 35% of people. A better way of testing it would be the human saliva, where the positivity would be about 75%. And the best is, of course, the fluid in the lung, which is called the bronchoalveolar lavage, that is BAL, where the positivity would be 90%. Now, coming back to this anecdote or the story, we have one member of the family who got fever of unexplained cause about 2 weeks back, tested for coronavirus, tested for COVID-19 by the PCR test and found to be negative. And within 2 weeks, my friend develops suddenly these personality changes. So I have a strong suspicion that this could have been a manifestation of COVID-19. And we have a paper, as I've just mentioned, we have a paper of 150 people collected in the United Kingdom. One third of these people did not have a stroke. They either had encephalitis or psychiatric changes in their personality. right? Of these 150 people, 92% were PCR positive. So therefore, they were considered to be confirmed cases of COVID-19. 4% were probable cases of COVID-19, which means they had no PCR test done, but they had bilateral ground glass appearance in their CT scans of the lungs. And 4% neither had a positive PCR test nor changes on the CT scan chest. And so therefore, they were assumed to be possible cases of COVID-19. But the fact remains that the people who had the encephalitis or the personality changes were PCR positive. So this virus can affect the brain and only the brain without affecting the lungs. That is a very important take-home message from this paper. The other fact is that I am a cardiologist, so that is my domain. I try not to speak about cardiology because I could bore you with the very small and minute details. But I have these three case reports. It is well established that all patients admitted with COVID-19 in hospitals, of them, almost 25% do have a cardiac complication. It may be small, it may be large, but the heart is affected. And this is assessed by the troponin levels. The troponin levels are invariably raised in these people. Now, I'll talk about these three case reports. One is a 69-year-old man who was admitted with fever and cough. The CT scan shows bilateral pneumonias. He is tested for all the viruses available which can affect the lungs, which are the adeno, the rhino, influenza, parainfluenza, respiratory syncytial virus, and stuff like that. They all turn out to be negative. At the same time, he is found to have some subtle changes on the ECG. An echo is done, an echocardiogram is done. The echo shows left ventricular hypertrophy, which is explained by the fact that this man who is 69 years has had hypertension in the past. So the changes could be because of the blood pressure. But the important thing is then they go ahead. The researchers went ahead and did a cardiac MRI. That is an MRI of the heart, and found the classic changes which are seen in acute myocarditis. Myocarditis means an acute inflammation of the heart by a virus, usually. Then they checked him for COVID-19 using the PCR test and found that it was positive. So the researchers have concluded, and possibly justifiably, that this man had COVID-19, had the classic presentation of fever, cough, and a CT scan of the chest, which revealed pneumonia of both lungs. And he also had confirmed myocarditis. Now, the researchers did not do a biopsy of the heart because they felt, and rightly so, that there was no need. The heart was not failing. The ejection fraction was normal. There were no serious arrhythmias. So therefore, the MRI itself was confirmatory. And so they suggested that in every case of COVID-19, it is imperative that troponins are done. And in the event of troponins being raised, an echo must be done to figure out if there is any cardiac involvement. Now, apart from this, this patient was from, I think, Italy. There are two more case reports. One is of a 16-year-old boy, and the other is of a 35-year-old man. The child's case report is published in The Lancet, and the 35-year-old man's case is published in the European Heart Journal. I will, of course, be providing the links to these two case reports. The hallmark of the two case reports is that both the 16-year-old boy and the 35-year-old man were admitted with chest pain. There was no fever, there was no cough, there were no changes on the X-ray, there were no changes on the CT scans of the lungs, but both had plus minus changes on the ECG, both had raised troponins, which is a marker for inflammation or damage of the heart. So both had increased troponins, both had an echocardiogram done, which revealed a normal contraction of the heart. There was mercifully no reduced ejection fraction, no lessening of contraction of the left or the right ventricle. But both had MRIs done, And again, the classic picture of myocarditis appeared, which is called enhancement of the gadolinium. There's an enhancement in the muscle wall. It is usually subepicardial. That means beneath the surface of the heart, within the heart muscle. And these changes can appear on any part of the ventricles, usually either the left, the inferior, or the lateral part of the heart. So now I have just summarized three cases. One did have changes in the lungs, but two were changes in the heart without any other classic symptoms or signs of COVID-19. So what these three case reports are underlining or underscoring is the fact that the heart can be affected directly without any involvement of the lungs. So here, there's a marked difference from SARS-1. So we find that there is the presence, there could be the presence of hyperglycemia, increased blood glucose because of infection by this virus, as opposed to SARS-1. The heart could be directly affected, but all these patients recovered by routine symptomatic treatment. They did not die. So this again is quite different. So therefore we find that this virus is completely different from SARS-1 in its clinical presentation. Now about the heart. The heart can be affected in a variety of ways. There can be an acute coronary syndrome, which means there could be a heart attack. The heart attack could be directly because of a thrombus formation, a rupture of a plaque in the coronary artery, and a thrombus formation and a classic acute myocardial infarction. Or there could be a blood oxygen mismatch, which means because of increased heart rate, because of increased coagulability, because of increased possibly blood pressure, there could be a type B or type 2 myocardial infarction. There could be arrhythmias, which could present as heart blocks, usually as atrial fibrillation, and also ventricular ectopic beats. And 6% of about 4,500 patients admitted in New York, 6% of them had a prolonged QT interval of more than 500 milliseconds. Now that is a very dangerous situation. So when you have that situation, you have to be very careful with drugs which increase the QT interval, such as hydroxychloroquine and azithromycin. So apart from poor functioning of the heart, which is also called a cardiomyopathy, of both the ventricles, the left and the right, the arrhythmias consisting of atrial fibrillation, ventricular ectopic beats, heart blocks, and of course, you can have acute coronary syndromes, and you could also have what is called cardiogenic shock. So we have two situations. The heart is affected in about 25 to 30% of people admitted in the hospital. And there can be people who can come into the hospital with only and solely infection of the heart directly or indirectly by this virus. Now, apart from the brain and the heart, the other organ which is affected is the kidney. Now again, the New York data has suggested that almost 35% of people present with acute kidney injury. That means there's a rapid increase of creatinine levels. There is proteinuria, there could be hematuria. And of these 35% who present with kidney damage, almost 15% could need dialysis. Why again is the kidney affected? Maybe again there is a direct attack by the virus on the kidneys, or because the arteries or the very tiny arteries supplying blood to the kidneys have inflammation, and because of this inflammation there are tiny clots formed which compromise the function of the kidney. So the common thread here is, which has been confirmed by autopsies, is that there is a vasculitis, there is a diffuse vasculitis, almost all the blood vessels are involved, there is inflammation of the blood vessel walls. Once there is inflammation of the walls, they become more thrombogenic, which means that the blood, well, in simple English, becomes thicker, there are clots formed, clots have been found in the lung, clots have been found in the arteries supplying the heart, clots have been found in the arteries supplying blood to the kidneys. And of course, also to the brain. And the other important thing is that it is not the large arteries which are only involved. The autopsy studies have shown again and again that the tiny arteries, what are called the arterioles, they are infected. They are affected and they are full of microthrombus or microthrombi, or very, very tiny blood clots. And that is the reason a lot of centers now, when they are confronted with a serious patient in a hospital demanding oxygen by a BiPAP or a ventilator, they start giving them anticoagulation, that is blood thinners. The preferred anticoagulant is a low molecular weight heparin, popularly known as Clexane, or a variety of names. But the fact remains that there is no guarantee that the blood thinners will work in preventing the blood clots. So I repeat again that what we are confronted with now is a clinical syndrome. It does not only affect the lungs. It can affect the heart, it can affect the brain, it can affect the kidneys, it can affect the liver, it can affect the endocrine system, and of course the intestines. So therefore, I regret calling this a respiratory virus. This is not a respiratory virus. This is in no way connected to the earlier virus. I have now started to believe, I am inclined to believe now with a certain degree of certitude that this was a psychops. This was a propaganda, calling this virus SARS-2 and making us believe that this was as harmful or as harmless as SARS-1. Of course, one has to keep in mind that SARS-1 had a mortality of 10%. This has a completely different mortality ratio, which is 0.1 to 0.2%, and that has been seen across the world. So that also I must emphasize, that despite the fact that this virus is capable of attacking the entire body and all the organs in the body, as also the skin, it still has a mortality of 0.1 to 0.2%. And some believe in India it is less than 0.1%. The news from Delhi is very good. I think on the 23rd of June, they had 4,000 new cases. And yesterday or day before, they have had only 1,000 new cases, 1,250 cases. This is a report given by the Indian Express today, which means that there is a substantial decline in the number of new cases. The number of deaths remain steady. They are very low. Even today, they are 17 or 18 per million, as opposed to 840 per million in Belgium and 650 per million in the United Kingdom, 430 million per million in the US, and 110 per million in Germany. 450 per million in France, and I think 650 per million in the United Kingdom, and 550 per million in Sweden, which of course never went under lockdown. So again, I would repeat what I told in the last video. There is a paper published just 3 or 4 days back in Nature, which has studied the capability of this new virus as opposed to the virus it mimics the most or is most closely connected, which is the rat G13 virus, the Rhinorhynchus affinis TG13 virus, which was discovered by the Chinese in 2013, and they strangely kept very quiet about this, despite the fact that the first 6 people affected by that virus, 3 died. So it had a case fatality of 50%, right? Despite that, and despite the fact that it is similar to the new virus to the tune of 96.2%, I repeat that the new virus resembles this virus, which was discovered in 2013, by 96.2% in its genetic material, but only 79% with the SARS-1 virus. Also, we have information, we have adequate data that the clinical picture is entirely different from SARS-1. SARS-1 never presented, or maybe the time given to us to examine the effects of that virus was too short. But the fact remains, there are very, very, or in fact, no reports of that virus affecting the brain, the heart, the intestines, apart, you know, apart from the lungs. That information is not with us. So I am inclined to believe that this virus is entirely different from that virus. The genetic study confirms that, and also the clinical picture. Now, the Nature article, which has appeared 3 or 4 days back, is from England, from the Francis Crick Institution. And this has shown, the researchers have shown, that the ability of this virus as compared to its closest cousin is 1,000 times more. It is 1,000 times more capable of infecting the human cell. It infects the human cell via the receptors called ACE2. ACE2 receptors are in the lungs, in the intestine, in the heart, in the kidney, and also in the brain. So now we get the clinical picture. We have a virus which is far, far more aggressive, far, far more dangerous than its closest cousin, the RAT-TG13 virus, discovered by the Chinese and in 2013. That's why it is called RAT-TG13. We know, and this has been established by these researchers, the paper is out there, you can read it yourself. The paper concludes that the ability of the new virus, the new China virus, is 1,000 times more than its closest cousin in its ability, in its capacity to infect human cells via the ACE2 receptors. So therefore, I conclude by making my case that this virus ought to be renamed. That, of course, will not happen, but I have stopped calling it the SARS-CoV-2 virus. Okay, thank you very much.